very, very warm welcome to everybody this evening for I Can't Do Art Live number 7. It's really good to have you here. Thank you for taking time out to be here to watch the live stream. I know many people watch it afterwards, but it's always really nice to have some people watching live, because it's a bit lonely otherwise, weirdly. Even though I can't see you, I know you're here. If you have any questions during the live stream, please feel free to ask. My husband will write them down on a piece of paper and he will hand them over to me. But, so, I think that's all you need to know. I'm just going to do a very little recap. For those of you who've done it before, please pick up your pens and pencils and start with your warm-up exercises, which for those of you who are new, this is something we do just to get the message to our brain that we're going to be doing some drawing rather than writing. And what we do is we doodle. Most people doodle, so most people have got a few doodles up their sleeve, and I tend to doodle stars and what I call frog spawn. Sometimes I do parallel lines, but if you just pick up your pen, let's get past that scary blank piece of paper moment and start to do a little bit of drawing to get us in the mood and to let our brains know that something's going to happen. Hello. Hello, Helen. Chloe, yes, it'll be nice to see you later, my lovely. And Jessica, good evening. Really nice to see you too, Jessica. Thank you. So, you keep on doodling. If a couple of things that will be helpful for you today, for your doodling, just to warm you up and get you in the zone, would be to have a go at drawing some large circles. Now, they don't have to be accurate. We're not looking for perfection here at all. In fact, if anything, slightly wobbly circles is probably more what we're aiming for. The other thing that would be helpful today would be to be drawing some long wavy lines. See if you can try and do them parallel. Perhaps some smaller circles, and perhaps even have a go at drawing a grid pattern like this. So if you get on with that while I'm talking, and I'm going to introduce today's subject as I usually do, and most of you will probably know that today we are going to be doing our own version of Charles Rennie Mackintosh art. And if you've seen on the page, I put up this week a couple of pictures of some of his work, and most people have heard of Charles Rennie Mackintosh, and if they didn't know it was by him, they've probably seen his work. So the first thing that I put up was this lovely picture of four of his pieces of work. Now, three of them are stained glass. This is in a chapel in Glasgow somewhere where he was from. These are stained glass windows, and these are tiles. And as you can see, he uses a mixture of very kind of organic curvy lines, as well as these quite geometric grid lines. And sometimes in his work, he sort of combines the two, but they're very much present overall in the work that he produced. And the other picture I'm going to hold up is, this is some of his fabric designs and wallpaper. And this probably is the most famous Rennie Mackintosh image, the thing that we most attribute to him, and that is his very stylized version of a rose. And as you can see, it's here, and it also appears in these pictures, and that became his sort of trademark, really. Now, Rennie Mackintosh was born in the 19th century. He lived He was born in Scotland, and when he was 17, he went to join an architect's firm, and so he studied on site as an architect. So much of Rennie Mackintosh's work is actually to be seen in buildings, which in his later life he actually designed and built entire buildings, most of which are in the Glasgow area, and they are exquisite. But he also went to the Glasgow School of Art when he was younger as a night class student, where he met a woman called Margaret MacDonald, who became his wife, but also he was very much his muse. And unfortunately, because she is actually a fantastic artist in her own right and very much his inspiration, but and this is actually her, this was a mural he did for a tea rooms in Glasgow, and this is actually her, and she's sort of enveloped in these lines, like she's inside a rose bush or something with these roses and things on, and as you can see, she's got a very sort of Edwardian look about her. And so we're going to have a go today at doing something like this for ourselves. Now, as you can see, in some of Rennie Mackintosh's work, and I've got two examples here to show you, he uses very kind of organic flow lines. And this is obviously a stained glass window, and the lines are quite heavy because obviously that's the leading between the glass. But he does also do that in his other work. Now, he created furnishings, he created wallpapers and soft furnishings. He put his design skills into all sorts of avenues, but mostly for having a sort of semi-practical purpose, and he made a great success of his life, and he's probably Glasgow's most famous son, really. Anyway, so in this one we've got nice organic curvy lines, like some of the things that we've done in previous classes. But in this one, there are still a lot of curves and organic lines, but what you can see from that is that there is a lot of symmetry. So if you take each pattern block, so this would have been designed as a pattern block and then printed onto fabric repeatedly to make this repeat pattern. But as you can see, whereas this one is not symmetrical, it's very sort of organic and very, therefore, very Art Nouveau, which was a big art movement in Britain. This one is more stylized still, and it has the symmetry and more of the straight lines that we'd recognize with things like Art Deco, which was a movement that he was also very influenced by, and he sort of bridges the gap between the two and kind of really makes it his own. But his work is beautiful. It's both delicate and striking. It's instantly recognisable as his kind of work. As soon as you see that rose, that stylized rose, you know it's Charles Rennie Mackintosh. And so what we are going to do today, as you know, I like to give you choices. So today's choice is that you either attempt, and I'll show you what I've done this week. So these are ones I prepared earlier, as usual. This is one that I've done that uses the much more sort of organic, fluid sort of lines. As you can see, it's not symmetrical. There is a little, this was actually an add-on. I put this grid pattern in, and this grid does appear in quite a lot of his work, particularly in his furniture and that sort of thing. So that's also very Rennie Mackintosh to have that. But mostly it's very sort of organic and nicely curvy. So you can do something like that, or if you'd rather have a go, and particularly if you did last week when we were making stencils, so you've had a bit of practice, then this is another one that I did. And this one, as you can see, is just completely symmetrical, with the sole exception of the rose in the middle, which again has his sort of organic shape. So it's entirely up to you which one you decide to do. So what we're going to do first, I'm going to break it down and show you how to draw some of the elements that go in to make up his work. Thank you, Judith. Judith said that's gorgeous. Oh, Judith, lovely to see you. Really lovely to see you, my dear. Been too long. Hello, Claire. Hello, Alice. Nice to see you. And to Suzanne from Texas. Wow. What should I say? G'day or something. No, that's Australian, isn't it? Anyway, how are you all doing? Perhaps that's better, but really nice to have you with us, Suzanne. I dread to think what time it is out there. But anyway, so you're going to think about which one you prefer to do. I'm going to find my glasses and we're going to have a go, first of all, at drawing a Rennie Mackintosh rose. So hopefully you've been doing some of these shapes and you can see now clearly how they're going to come in to help doing our finished product. Now, I use a pen so that you can see what I'm doing, but my advice, as always, is for you to use a pencil so that if necessary, you can rub out anything that you're not happy with, and that makes life a lot easier. And then if you want, because I've done these with a very heavy black line to make it look more like the stained glass, more like the Rennie Mackintosh, you can always go over it again with a pen afterwards once you're happy with the finished product. Okay, so the best way to start doing a rose is to give yourself a little bit of a guide. So if you draw yourself, or if you want, you can draw around something, but as I said earlier, his roses aren't completely circular. They are slightly wobbly, which is, let's face it, what roses are really like. So we're going to draw a circle, and that's going to be our guide. And what that means is that our rose is going to sit inside of there. And therefore we control what goes on around the rest of the page as well by knowing how big we're going to do our rows. Now I want you to watch this. It's very simple, okay? But just follow. We're going to draw a single line without necessarily taking our pen off the paper to create our rows. And the way I generally start is with a triangle shape, okay? So a triangle, and that is the centre of my rose. And then from there, I'm going to add my petals. And I'm literally just going to take a loop out, come back, touch the triangle, go out again, loop out, come in, touch the first petal. Then I'm going to head off out again, bring it back in. So as you can see, we're adding layers of petals. So I keep my pen where it was, carry on, and they're slowly getting bigger and bigger, as they would indeed on a rose. Now, one good thing to do to make it very Rennie Mackintosh is to, when you bring your line back in, to bring it back in, not where the petals meet, but actually bring it back in onto the back of the petal that it's closing in on. So if we carry on, another one, it's getting slightly bigger each time. So it's a spiral, effectively, that we're drawing, but it's not like an amethyst. It's not a perfect spiral, like a snail shell or something. It's actually quite, like I say, it's a little bit wibbly-wobbly, and that's what gives it that organic look. Oh, hello, Ali. Nice to have you here. Thanks for joining in. Okay, so that's our first rose. Now, I suggest that you have a couple of practices at that. If I wanted to, I could go on and add another one here to fill up the page a bit more. But I was really and truly, I was quite happy with that, how it was. So, just one more time, we'll go through this. And this is our Rennie Mackintosh rose. Here we go. So, start with a little triangle. It's the very centre of the rose before it's fully opened, and then off we go with our curves. Bring them round and touch back. Bring it round again and touch back. Off we go again. It's like we're sort of orbiting the centre of the flower. So we go off and we touch down. We go off again. Are you getting this? and we touched down. You've probably all done about five of them already, and you're thinking, come on, Helene, get on with it. That's the job done. But I'm going to continue just to show you. You can do a really small one if you want. I mean, if you look closely at his flowers, particularly, I'll pick it up in a minute. Here we are, final one coming in now, and touch down. So there we are, Rennie Mackintosh rose. Now, if you look on this one, that his famous picture, which is actually called Roses with Teardrops, which is what these little white things are, you'll see that they come in all kinds of shapes. They're generally circular, you know, in the broad scheme of things, but they're not completely circular. And that, I think, is what gives it, you know, that real sort of Rennie Mackintosh flavour, is that he hasn't done them completely circular. Now, I say that, and then you can see on this one that he's made this completely symmetrical. So this flower is the same on this half and the same on that half. And that's something you can do if you want. But if you really want that true Rennie Mackintosh style, then do it this way and you will get yourself a nice flower. Now, before we move on, I'm just going to give you a little tip about how to, if you're going to be using colours, how to make this sort of very Mackintosh-y. Now, obviously, he was painting. When he did paintings, he used paintings. He was a great watercolour artist, actually. Kath, you're here, hooray! Really nice to see you, Catherine, in sunny Norfolk. His pictures are done with watercolours, so you can see it's not a block colour on here. You can see that the colour fades in and fades out, and that's something you can easily do with watercolours. If that's something you want to do, then have a go at it. But if you don't have watercolours, felt pens are fine, colouring pencils, whatever. But how I get that effect of it not being just a block, flat block colour, is I use two pens. I choose colours that are close to one another on the colour wheel. You don't have to do them red. You can do that. You can choose any colours you want to do this. It doesn't have to be red or this deep maroon that Rennie Mackintosh uses a lot, because that was very fashionable back in the turn of the last century when he was doing all this kind of stuff. But I simply just colour in the shapes that I've made, and I just kind of alternate the colours a little bit, and that gives you, so I've decided that overall it's going to be red, and so most of the petals will be red, but occasionally I will throw in one of these sort of purpley pink ones just to give it, you know, I'm doing this really quickly and quite shoddily, but you've got time to take your time and do this. So every now and then I will throw in a sort of purpley pink one, and that will just give it a bit more dynamic than if I was just doing it as a block colour. So there you are, you've got your Rennie Mackintosh rose. Now another flower that he frequently draws, and that does add a bit more life and give you options as well. We all like to have options, don't we? I did one of these the other day. I really enjoyed doing these because really, once you've done a few and you get into the zone with them, they're so straightforward and yet so effective. So I did this one yesterday. It literally took me about 25 minutes to do. And as you can see, I've used the grid pattern that frequently appears in his work. As you can see on here, you can see the grid pattern has been used. I think it appears on this one as well. And what he does also, when he does these organic ones, he does use horizontal lines as well. It's like he's, I don't know, these stems, I'm not sure entirely, because there's a little bit of abstract in there, but he uses these horizontal lines, not always horizontally, some of them are diagonally, obviously he's following the curve there, but to kind of break it up. And again, it adds that real sort of Rennie Mackintosh. And as you can see on this one, I have done that as well. I've used some of those vertical line, horizontal lines, sorry, and vertical lines actually, just to add to it and to give it that Rennie Mackintosh look. And the other thing that he does, which I want you to have a think about when you're doing it, is that he adds these circles. Now, he probably does that on the stained glass window, though he's done it on the tiles here. It adds interest. If you can imagine it without it, it really does add something. It's a really simple but very effective way to add extra dimensions. So as you can see, I've done on here, I've just plonked, and I didn't really plonk them. I did think about it. There's quite a bit of rubbing out gone on here. I tried putting one in down there and it didn't look quite right, so I rubbed it out, and that's fine. You know, you learn by doing. So, you know, think about adding some of those in to give it that real Rennie Mackintosh look. Now, the other shape that we're gonna have a go at, which again is very simple, is the tulip shape. So let me just show you, if you pick up your pencil again, the tulip shape is basically a loose triangular shape. So you can start wherever you want to. I usually start at the top when I'm drawing triangular sort of shapes. So start at the top, bring it down, curve, give it a nice curvy bottom, and then come up to the top like that, and you've got a tulip shape. It's very simple. Again, it doesn't have to be perfect and symmetrical. You can give it a bit of a bend. You know, tulips aren't, you know, they are organic, so we are allowed to play a little bit with the shapes of things, and we're allowed to just do it freehand because it can still look effective. Now, the other thing he's done that I have imitated here is, because he does, again, stained glass windows, to change colour, he obviously has to have this thick line in between them, which would be the leading, but it looks really cool when you add it in, even though you're not making a stained glass window. It really adds to it, and he didn't just incorporate that in his stained glass either. He used it in his other designs as well. So literally, to do the stem, I've just curve a line through the flower as though it's a closed up tulip, and then bring it down like that. And before you know it, you have got a beautiful, I hope you can see this, let me turn that around, you've got a beautiful Rennie Mackintosh style tulip. Okay, so the only other thing you're going to think about, you're going to make your own composition, you're going to use elements of this, you're going to think about the grids, you're going to think about if you have any sort of parallel lines, if they're curves, if you're going to do a curvy one, like that. When you finish drawing it out, you can add in some horizontals, the odd circle, like that, and immediately it starts to look very Rennie Mackintosh. Okay, now, one thing that you might all want to do before you crack on, okay, if you're going to do the kind of organic one, like these ones, okay, you can do what I did, which was put a frame around it. Now, whether you're going to do a symmetrical one or an organic one, it does look quite nice if you frame it like this. So this is a framed one, but obviously it's very symmetrical. But even if you use the frame and then did your own organic one, okay? Now, this is where the scissors come in, okay? So to make our frame, it doesn't have to be this shape. You could have, I mean, this one is almost a complete oval shape on here. This is an interesting frame. These are tulips, and this is an interesting frame. So it's sort of curved at the top, and then it's got like a V at the bottom, if you can see that, okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to make our frame. So we're going to get a nice piece of paper. Now we're going to decide whether we want our picture, our finished picture, to be landscape or portrait. Okay, I'm going to do mine portrait, but you can do yours landscape if you like, that's fine. I'm going to get another sheet of paper, and because I'm doing mine portrait, I'm going to fold it in half, and I'm going to draw myself a frame, which I'm then going to cut out and make a stencil. So that saves me the big job of trying to get both sides completely symmetrical so that it looks substantial. So when we did this last week with the faces, don't forget, leave a gap at the top, at the side and at the bottom so that you know it's going to fit nicely on the page. Now, if I was going to do this shape of frame, I'll do this one so that you can see. I would use a ruler just because it's quicker, but you can freehand if you want. So I'm just going to put my ruler on the bottom of the page and draw a straight line across. And I'm going to put my ruler at the side of the page and draw a straight line up. And that gives me the base of my arched window. And then freehand from about halfway up, or there just above, I'm going to take a curve over to the top of my piece of paper. Actually, let me go a bit lower down, it's a bit too high. There we go, like that. When you're drawing a big shape like that, it's good to kind of have your hand, anchor your hand down so that your line remains constant. That does help. But a little bit of trial and error and you'll get there. And the next thing I'm going to do, as you all know, is cut it out. And I really need to say this to you, because a lot of people think that doing things like this, making stencils for yourself, is kind of cheating. And it really isn't. It really isn't. Artists do this sort of thing all the time. I know I've mentioned Banksy before. He uses stencils for all his work, for all kinds of good reasons, not least of all because he's got to do it really quickly and run off before anyone sees him. So he makes a stencil in his studio and then takes it out. But artists do this all the time, okay? I know artists that are wonderful portrait painters, and they project a photograph with an overhead projector onto the canvas, and they literally use that like a stencil and draw around the lines that they see. It's not cheating. It's not cheating. It's just a way of doing things, okay? So I've got my stencil now, as you can see. I'm going to put that on my page and draw around it. I'll do it with my pen, because then you can see. Here we go. And there we are. I've got myself a nice... if I can do it properly. I've actually gone offline here, because... This is why you do it in pencil, because you don't get that sort of thing. Or if you do, you can just rub it out. So that's my starting point. Now, if you want to do an organic one, and you're going to put a rose in, my advice to you is to start with your rose, and then work around it, because that is your main feature. And if you want to put more than one rose, you can fill it up with roses if you want, and that would be really effective. But if you want to use some of the other elements, the grids, the lines with the circles in and stuff, do it. If you want to do something symmetrical like this, we have the beginnings of a stencil. Now, if I had time, I would do this on another piece of paper. In fact, you know what? I'm going to ask my husband to cut this out for me, because it's really, if you're doing a stencil, it's good to have two starting templates, because when you start cutting it down, you might want to add a bit and find you've already cut that little bit off. So I'm going to ask my husband to cut that, my glamorous assistant, to cut that out for me, so in case I need it, I've got a spare. Because once you've started cutting your stencil down, there's not much going back really, so it's good to have a spare one. So here we are. I'm drawing around this again badly because I'm rushing it, but you don't need to. And I'm going to give myself a nice arch shape. My husband and I were married. Oh, how long have we been married, Lee? 22 years ago. And our wedding invitations, our wedding cake, and all our order of services all had Rennie Mackintosh roses on, which Lee and I both drew up. And I did the design for the cake and everything, but it was a total Rennie Mackintosh fest. So we have very fond memories of Rennie Mackintosh, but the reason I'm telling you that is because being able to draw this rose, or the tulips, They are really simple but very beautiful designs, and if you ever want to do anything like giving someone a handmade card, a birthday card or something like that, it's a really easy thing to do. Do a little, cut out a little arch like this, put it on a blank card or, you know, whatever, and then do a rose in the middle. And it's really effective, and as you can see, really quite easy to do. And he doesn't love a handmade card, you know? So Rennie Mackintosh stuff really lends itself to that sort of thing. Oh, before I crack on with this, I'm just going to show you this. You might want to take a screenshot of it. It's the Rennie Mackintosh alphabet. It's his font. And as you can see, it's got these wonderful horizontal lines and these little squares and things. I love the capital O and the Q. If I look at the lowercase Q, they're just fantastic. I really, really like them. And if you want to have a go at putting some lettering on, you can just Google Rennie Mackintosh lettering and have a go at that. We did do lettering before, but as you can see, I had a go at using it, and actually it was quite good fun. You can always print it off and trace it as well if you want. That's another thing. So here we are. What's the time? We've got 15 minutes. That's great. So we've got our template for our arch. What we're going to do then, we're going to decide on a basic design, which is going to be formed around the rose in the middle. So the first thing I'm going to draw is but we're only going to draw half of it, and then we're going to cut it out and replicate that half so that we have a nice symmetrical shape. So I'm going to draw a space where my semicircle, where my rose is going to sit. So that's the number one part of the deal, okay? Then I'm going to, like I've done here, just do some lines that sort of frame it. And so let's have a line that comes up to the top, around the side, and wiggles down to the beginning, okay? Let me do this in pen, sorry. Forgot what I was doing then. I was so getting in the zone, I forgot that you were even there for a second. So, a semicircle for my rose. And I've done a nice wiggly line going down here, like this. And because I want to be able to put in some of those horizontals, I'm going to do another wiggly line that's sort of parallel, so that I can do that horizontal stripey thing that he does. Okay, I'm going to keep this fairly simple so that I can do it in the time that we've got. I'm going to put something that looks a bit like a leaf here, so it's going to follow that line again. And again, you can have fun with this. You don't have to do what I'm doing. You can totally have fun with this. But, you know, draw something, see what you think of it. If you don't like it, oh, that's gone a bit. Let's try and get a straight line there. Okay, so I've got these basic shapes now. So what I'm going to do now, with my scissors, I'm going to start cutting out the shapes and fitting it on. I'm going to start with the rose thing, because obviously the more you cut off this stencil you're making, the flimsier it gets. So I need to be able to kind of think to myself what's going to make the most sense to cut off first without it becoming so flimsy that I can't really use it. So if I put that back in position, I've cut my circle out where my rose is, and I can draw a circle there, and that will be the guide for when I come to draw my rose. And there it is. Okay, so the next thing that makes sense to cut out is to probably the next thing that makes sense is probably to cut out this line here. So if I just cut down this line, here we go. Oh, I do like cutting things out actually, it's quite satisfying. Oh, there we go. So now I can use either that as a template, or I can use this one. It's probably easier to use this because it's got the outside line, so that I know I've got a better idea of it being positioned in the right place. So there we are. beautifully in position and then holding it down very carefully. And I should say, if you've got heavier duty paper, this is literally just, you know, photocopying paper, so it's very flimsy. And I don't buy expensive photocopying paper, so it might even be flimsier still. It's kind of one grade up from tissue paper. But if you've got something a bit sturdier to make your stencil with, that will be helpful. But as you're doing it in pencil, you can just, you know, you can just do it as you go. You can rub out what goes wrong and add in bits. So there we are, I've done my first outline for my rose. So then obviously the next thing is to follow the second line again and cut it down. Rebecca Simmons says she's missed this, so I hope you mean that you've missed watching this and not that you've missed what we're supposed to be doing. I hope I'm explaining it clear enough for you, Rebecca. So the next one, here we go, I'm cutting it down again, and you know what I'm going to do. You know, when you're cutting, try and keep both sides. I'm doing this, I'm talking to you, I'm doing this, I'm watching the screen, I'm totally multitasking here. I could do a better job, and I'm sure you will do a much better job. So here we are, again, I've got my, getting much flimsier by the minute, my stencil, there we go. Is it in place? It's just about in place. There we go. And again, I can draw around that to get the shape that I want. Oh. Now I do because I've got quite a short attention span, I do a lot of my artwork using what young people would call hacks. This is kind of a hack, you know. I could sit here with my pencil, you know, right, I'm going to draw an archway, and I could, you know, do all that. I could spend a long time doing that. Fair play, there's nothing wrong with doing that. If you get pleasure out of doing that and it's not going to stop you, go ahead. For me, because I've got a short attention span, I want to get on to the bit that I really like, which is actually colouring in. So I try and make this bit as effortless as possible. So there we are, which is why I tend to use stencils. And really all art, it doesn't matter if you're Michelangelo or me or you know, or any of us, art is really about drawing shapes and colouring them in. You know, that is basically the bottom line of what art is about, drawing shapes and colouring them in. If you like drawing shapes, draw the shapes freehand. If you don't like drawing shapes freehand so much because you're too impatient like me, then find ways around that are going to enable you to do the bits that you really do like. Now, because I was talking then, I've made a bit of a mistake. I shouldn't have cut off that tiny bit at the bottom, but no matter. So I'm now cutting out this shape here. And I'm going to do this because this is way too flimsy to draw out now. But if I wanted to, I could start using this one again to add bits in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to position it, draw around it, flip it over so that it can then fit in onto the other side. Nick says he can't wait to have a go at doing this. He loves these designs. They are fabulous, aren't they? They're so, they're kind of, because they're quite organic, they're really calming, you know, like being in nature is very calming. But they also have this really kind of, with the kind of funky things like the dots and the lines. I mean, he was doing this over 100 years ago. And it's still as cool today as it was back then. Imagine, you know, at the time, you know, this would have been quite radical. Like I say, of all the artists we've talked about over the weeks, he was actually one that made a success of his life. You know, he actually, probably because he studied architecture, and so people were more open to, it was a practical outlet for his art. Whereas most artists who are painting pictures and that sort of thing, and cutting new ground with their designs and how they're seeing the world, so many of them, you know, die prematurely with diseases related to poverty. You know, we talked about Modigliani last week, and he, poor soul, you know, he died of consumption and when he was 35. So the starving artist thing is not just a joke, it's actually true. But anyway, Mackintosh made a good living out of it, and so he did all right, and he lived till he was 60. So here we are. So there you are. I've got my basic shape. It's very blotchy and stuff. What I will do afterwards is I will go over it and straighten up these lines and make them look neat. But most of my pictures start off like this, little, you know, squiggly lines and stuff. I would probably, if I had a bit more time, I'd probably do something with this piece and have something in the middle. There's no reason why I can't. We've got a few more minutes, so let's just, I'm going to make a sort of vase shape and just put that in there. Kat says that her and her daughters, she's got two of the most beautiful daughters, are really enjoying doing this. That's fantastic. That is fantastic. It is really good fun. And, you know, I try and make all these art groups fun, because if it's not fun, I think, what's the point? We've all got enough work in our lives, we've all got enough things that we have to do that aren't necessarily that much fun. This really is, as I've said before, this is about you time, about being mindful, about being in the moment. When you're doing this, you're not going to be thinking about things that are going on in the world, or even perhaps in the next room, you know, you're just in the zone, and it gives you some peace. But not only that, at the end of it, you have got something that you have created that wouldn't have existed in the world had you not done this. You have literally engaged with the process of creation, and you know, that makes you a god or a goddess, because you've created something, in my opinion. So there we are, cut out my last shape, I'm going to put that there, and here we go. So you can see what I've done there, hopefully you're able to see that. So then what I would do, I've now got this shape, I would now start filling in the details. Jessica says my stenciling technique has revolutionised artful. I'm really pleased, Jessica, because the trouble is, if you don't pursue art past sort of high school, you don't realise it. There's, at high school, the emphasis is so much on being able to draw picture perfect things, and that is, you know, that is a skill in its own right. But if you can't do that, doesn't mean you're not an artist. And that's the problem, is that people get the message that if they can't draw a fantastic sketch of a hand or, you know, a human body or whatever, that they're not an artist. We might not all make it to the National Gallery with our work, but you don't have, you know, it's about expectations on ourselves. And so, you know, go easy on yourself, and like I say, if this is going to enable you to produce something that you thought you couldn't do, then the only conclusion you can come to then is that actually you can do it. You can do it. Okay? So, and Rennie Mackintosh was an architect. He would have been using all kinds of tools, let me tell you, to get the results that he wanted. He was a great freehand drawer as well, but he only went to night school, you know, he studied architecture. But he would have used, combined his skills of architecture, which would have used all this kind of stuff, with his art to create a finished product. So just to finish this off now, as I'm wittering away, you know I get very passionate about this because I think it's so important for people to have creative outlets. It's so good for your mental well-being because if nothing else, it gives you time out. These last 45 minutes or whatever, hopefully you've really experienced that feeling of just being kind of away with the fairies, you know, just away in a nice place in your mind doing something, and it's not escape because you are being productive. And so we have that drilled into us from a very early age, you must be productive. Well, this is productive, so you can tick that box as well. I don't think you always have to be productive, but you know, there we are. So I've got my rose in the middle, and if I was to carry on, if we had time and we could all sit around a table, wouldn't that be lovely? If we could all sit around a table and do this and be like, oh, I like that, might put one of those in, you know. So I would probably do some things like put in some random circles. I'd think about it a little bit more than I'm doing now, but I would probably do that. Now, the one last thing I want to say to you about Rennie Mackintosh, I might even make a grid here. Now, you can do your grids freehand, or you can use your ruler, centimetre squares, you know, if you want to. Some people find doing that very stressful. It's fine, you know, if you want to do it freehand, have a go freehand. You know, we're not trying to copy Rennie Mackintosh to the T. We're just using, you know, the gift he's given us of his work. We're using that to produce something that we like, and because we like looking at his work, we will enjoy looking at our own as well. And you can do this over and over and over, and obviously the more you do it, the better you get at it, like anything. So the one other thing I was going to say, as I get carried away, as you know, was colour schemes. Now, Rennie Mackintosh was doing this at the turn of the last century for the most part. He died, I think, in 28, something like that. And the colours that were very fashionable at that time were these sort of mint greens, if you think of the 1920s and that sort of thing. So mint greens, quite muted greens and blues. And then in conjunction with these sort of purpley pinks and reds. Okay, so this is kind of a very Mackintosh sort of colour scheme. However, as you can see, I played fast and loose with a bit with it. I did this one, these are some of my doodles. I did this one, which has got my favourite colour scheme, which happens to be orange and blue. So you can go mad with the colours. You can use, as I've said before, you can use every colour in the box, or you can think about, you know, just using one or two colours, or, you know, so play. But don't feel like you have to be tied to those Rennie Mackintosh colours. That's basically what I'm saying. Using those colours, it's just an option. It's an option. Okay. So, I think we're almost out of time now. Oh, in fact we are. We're running a bit over. So what I'm going to say, as I always say, please send me your work, because that's kind of the validating bit for me. I put it into the gallery each week, and I don't put your names on it, but you're very welcome to tag yourself if you want to be able to share your work, you know, elsewhere. Please feel free to tag you, but I do it anonymously because, you know, it's, if you've had that message at any time in your life that you can't do art, then you might not feel confident enough to have your work labelled. But I would really encourage you to tag yourself, because everything you've done, everything you do is making something new, and every stroke on the paper is a stroke in towards you growing in confidence. And so everything you produce has worth. Even if you're not happy with it, it's taught you how not to do it. So it's really, you know, it's good for you to be able to kind of own what you're doing and feel proud of what you've done, because I'm always very proud. So please send it through. If anybody does want to contribute to the groups, I will put the PayPal link at the bottom. It's not mandatory. I do this because I love doing it, and I really want you to be able to access your inner artists and, you know, have fun. But if you want to contribute to the time and effort, I will put the PayPal link at the bottom, and thank you for those that do. It's really very much appreciated. So that's it for this week. It's nearly time for us to go out and do our rounds of applause. So I hope you've understood all this and that you've managed to produce something that you're really happy with, and I really look forward to seeing them. So you take care, have a great week. Much love. Bye-bye.